Hi, everybody. I'm Jimmy DeYoung. I want to welcome you to another edition of Prophecy Today Intelligence Briefing. Saudi Arabia wants President Trump to do a preemptive strike on Iran. That's the headline today. Ken Timmerman is going to come to the broadcast table to give us more details. I'll also talk with Ken about the situation in the Biden administration. How will Joe Biden, if he is indeed president, handle Russia, Saudi Arabia, and in fact, the entire Middle East? This is going to be a very important intelligence briefing. I want you to stay tuned. We'll get to Ken Timmerman in just a moment. I want to remind you that I have a prophecy bookstore on my website, prophecytoday.com, and at that bookstore, we have a number of source materials that will assist you in your study of Bible prophecy. I'm holding in my hand here one of the items that would be so helpful, so beneficial for you to have at your side as you study the prophetic Word of God. This five-hour audio series on CD is entitled Alignment of the Nations. This is one of the major trends in Bible prophecy. It's key that you understand how the entire Middle East will come against the Jewish state of Israel and how the nations will align themselves to do exactly that. I would suggest you go to my prophecy bookstore. It's located on my website, prophecytoday.com, and get your copy of this five-hour audio series on CD entitled Alignment of the Nations. And right now, then, we're going to go to Ken Timmerman, who has come to the broadcast table to give us his detailed information about why Saudi Arabia is calling on President Trump to do a preemptive strike on Iran. Ken, I want to go to the Middle East because the Saudis are very much alarmed at the prospect that a Joe Biden presidency will be that they will rejoin the Iranian nuclear deal. Now, it may not be a big deal as far, and no pun intended, a big deal as far as Biden is concerned, but it is a big deal for the Saudis, isn't it?
Well, it really is a big deal, Jimmy. Should a Biden administration resurrect this failed Iran deal, remove U.S. sanctions, give Iran once again a pathway to make nuclear weapons, it will have dramatic repercussions, not just for the United States, not just for Iran, not just for Israel, but all of Iran's neighbors in the Middle East and for Europe as well, because Europe will be within range of Iran's nuclear-tipped or potentially nuclear-tipped ballistic missiles. Here's the irony of all of this. The Saudis will, in all likelihood, get closer to Israel as a result. And they're already making signals of that this week. While the Saudi king did congratulate Joe Biden for his apparent win, or at least the media acknowledged win as president, the Saudis at the same time are going to meet with the Israelis. And you could see a Saudi-Israeli partnership, perhaps not as members of the Abraham Accords, but a partnership that is much more open than what we've had so far, and that could involve military cooperation against Iran. I believe that we are heading into very dangerous times these next couple of weeks. There was a report a few days ago that President Trump had asked his intelligence agencies and the Pentagon for possible war plans against Iran, or at least strike plans against Iranian nuclear sites. This is something that the Saudis would in all likelihood favor. They have been pushing President Trump for years to launch an attack on Iran, and the president has refused to do so, saying that there had not been an Iranian attack on the U.S. But now he's sending his chief Middle East advisor, Elliot Abrams, to Saudi Arabia this coming week. Abrams will also visit Israel. He will visit the United Arab Emirates, from what I understand. And on the table will clearly be some type of measures that the U.S. can take in conjunction with the Saudis and our Arab allies against Iran in the prospect of a Biden presidency. In other words, something that we could do together with our allies to forestall any Biden loosening of sanctions and resumption of the Iran nuclear deal.
Well, Ken, I had heard that that was a viable possibility, that President Trump would give the command to go ahead and do that. However, his aides had talked him out of it, but you're saying it's still on the table, could happen very quickly.
I think it is still on the table, and I think that's how I read this visit by Elliot Abrams to the Middle East next week. And, you know, the other thing that I've got to comment on is that no sooner had the president asked his intelligence chiefs and the Pentagon for potential strike plans against Iranian nuclear sites, then it was leaked to the New York Times. And by the way, that's one of the reasons why the president fired Pentagon Chief Esper, you know, the Secretary of Defense Esper, and replaced him with somebody from the National Security Council who is a former CIA officer, but also a trusted collaborator of the president.
Ken, you know, it's interesting to me that the Arab nations out there are warning the incoming Biden administration, if indeed that is what happens, they had better not embrace the Islamists.
Well, that's right. Both the Saudis and the Egyptians have had contacts with people close to Biden and have said, look, we saw what happened when Obama was president. You took sides with the Muslim Brotherhood. You helped to spark the Arab Spring, which has been a catastrophe, not just for governments, but for people all across the Arab world. Look at Libya. Libya today is still a wreck. It is a smoking ruin because of Obama and Hillary Clinton and Joe Biden's support for the Arab Spring. So the Egyptians and the Saudis are telling these people close to Biden, look, please do not do this again. We will not allow you to get away with it. Now, what will they do to forestall a potential U.S. government cozying up to the Muslim Brotherhood? Good question. Will they help regimes in place? Quite possibly. There was no response from Arab leaders in 2011 when Obama clearly swung behind the Muslim Brotherhood. This time they are forewarned. They can see what a catastrophe that policy would be. And I think that is why they're warning an incoming Biden administration, should there be one, that they will take action to prevent a U.S. alliance with the Muslim Brotherhood.
And at the same time that the world is concerned about a nuclear-powered Iran, I get a report out of Iraq that the Iraqi militia are acquiring all types of weapons, rockets and munitions and every type of weapon they might need to try to take over Iraq from the Iranians. Now, this is not very good for the stability of the Middle East, is it, Ken?
No, and people need to understand, the powers who have been really heartened by a Biden victory in the United States are not friends of the United States. Russia has been emboldened and pleased by the apparent election results. China has been pleased by the apparent election results. Iran is exulting, and they are, as you mentioned, they are beefing up the missile and strike capabilities of those militias in Iraq in the hopes of driving the United States out completely from Iraq, not just to reduce our presence, as President Trump has said we're going to do, but to drive us out completely. So this is very dangerous. This is why I say we are entering dangerous times. The Muslim Brotherhood is happy. The Palestinian leadership is happy with this potential Biden victory. All of America's enemies seem to be happy. What's wrong with this picture, folks?
Indeed, what is wrong with that picture? Well, we're talking about Iran. Let me just bring this story to your attention as well, Ken. It's being told that Iran has a truly ridiculous stockpile of missiles. In other words, so many they don't know what to do with. Maybe that's why they're selling some of them to the Iraqi militia. But this stockpile, along with the possibility of a nuclear warhead, sounds dangerous to me. What are your thoughts?
Well, it is. And the Iranians, many, many years ago, made a strategic decision to neglect their conventional war capabilities, to not buy, you know, thousands of tanks and artillery pieces and all of that. This is, of course, after their eight-year war with Saddam Hussein was finished. And instead to invest in unconventional warfare, to invest in ballistic missiles, to invest in shorter-range rockets, standoff weapons, coastal missiles, missiles that could attack U.S. warships in the Strait of Hormuz, these fast attack boats that could swarm American ships in the Strait of Hormuz. But they're not buying fighter jets in big quantities. They're not buying main battle tanks. They're putting their money in missiles and standoff weaponry. And yes, I think as they have ramped up those production capabilities, they have been encouraged to just spread them anywhere they possibly can as a way of creating mischief for the United States and for our ally Israel. As we've said many, many times on this program, there are 150,000 Iranian missiles in Lebanon pointed at Israel. There are many thousands in Gaza pointed at Israel. There are many thousands in Syria pointed at Israel. And now you have them also being pointed at Israel and U.S. bases around the region in Iraq.
Well, and in fact, I've been reading reports, Ken, that Iran's army is pretty strong as it relates to an army on the ground. But really, that's not what we should be so much concerned about as the Iranian Revolutionary Guard Corps, which seems to be the main threat, the real power broker. What can you tell us?
Well, that's right. So the Iranians have invested in the IRGC, the Revolutionary Guards Corps. They've invested especially in the Quds Force, which is the overseas expeditionary arm, again, as part of their unconventional weapons strategy, unconventional forces strategy. Rather than go head-to-head with the United States, soldier for soldier, unit for unit, they try to go around the obstacles to attack us through terrorism, with IEDs, with standoff missiles. That is their strategy. It's unconventional warfare. It's terrorism, which they use as an arm of their foreign policy.
Just quickly, if you will, I understand there's going to be a Russian movement to build a naval base there in Sudan, which may well be a crucial step in restoring Russian maritime power. This is not looking good.
Well, I got to say, I was a bit taken aback reading that report, Jimmy, especially since Sudan has now been taken off the U.S. terrorism list. We have some juice in Sudan, and I think it's a time for the president to use that juice. We don't want to see a Russian naval base in the Red Sea.
Great information from Ken Timmerman, my broadcast partner, who covers geopolitical events happening around the world. In that report, Ken referred to several nations, Russia, Saudi Arabia, and Iran. Let me suggest to you that those three are major players in the prophetic scenario that is found in God's Word. If you have your Bible, I would love for you to go to the book of Psalm, chapter 83, and we'll go to verse 6. Let me just read from this verse of Scripture there in Psalm 83. Verse 6 says, "The tabernacles of Edom and the Ishmaelites." Now that is referring to the descendants of Ishmael, Genesis chapter 16. In Genesis chapter 17 in verse 20, the Lord told Abraham that his son Ishmael would establish one nation. That nation at that time was referred to as Arabia. It is Saudi Arabia today. You might remember that if you go to the 25th chapter of the book of Genesis in verse 18, we see a description of the land of the nation that Ishmael would establish as the one nation that would be Saudi Arabia. And then if you'll take your Bible and go over to Ezekiel chapter 38, we see in verse 2 that it mentions a nation who will be the nation that will be involved in leading the alignment of Islamic nations against the Jewish state of Israel. Ezekiel chapter 38 and verse 2. "Son of man," that's Ezekiel's statement, and that who is the Lord is referring to, son of man, Ezekiel, "son of man, set thy face against Gog in the land of Magog." Now, Gog is the personality. Magog is the place, the piece of real estate that would be a nation sometime after. One of the grandsons of Noah, actually the son of Japheth, would move to a piece of real estate north of the Black and Caspian Sea. That piece of real estate today is Russia. So Ezekiel chapter 38 and verse 2 is referring to Russia. Gog would be the leader of Russia, Magog, the location of Russia. And in verse 5 of Ezekiel chapter 38, it begins with Persia, another of the nations that will align them with themselves with the nations that will destroy or endeavor to destroy the Jewish state of Israel. When you look at Persia, we're talking about the Medo-Persian Empire of the past, but Persia in 1936 had their name changed from Persia to Iran. So we're talking about Iran. So here we have in Psalm 83 and verse 6, the Ishmaelites, Saudi Arabia, in the book of Ezekiel, chapter 38 and verse 2, Magog, which is Russia, and in verse 5, Persia, which is modern-day Iran. Now, these nations are going to align themselves and put together an attack team, a military operation to try to destroy the Jewish state of Israel. I understand that Saudi Arabia and Iran are enemies today. However, I understand the last chapter, and that's the Word of God, and this is the absolute that will take place in the end times. Russia is going to be the leader of this alignment of Islamic nations who want to destroy the Jewish state of Israel. As we look at the events unfolding in the Middle East, we must recognize that that stage for the fulfillment of these prophecies that we have talked about, that stage is being set, and it could begin any moment. Well, there is a criteria by which that battle, the Gog-Magog battle against the Jewish state of Israel, will take place. It has to happen after the rapture of the church and in the first 6 months of that tribulation period. Did you hear what I said? It happens after the rapture of the church. If you know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, we'll be taken out before the Gog-Magog battle begins. But however, at this point in time, we can see everything being set for that battle to begin, just waiting on the rapture to happen. And by the way, if you're watching this Prophecy Today intelligence briefing, and you don't know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, you need to admit you're a sinner. I did when I was 11 years old. You need to do that. Believe in the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. That's the gospel which will give you salvation. And then call upon Him. Very simple move to make. Childlike activity and belief. Simply call upon the Lord, Romans chapter 10 and verse 13, and He will save you. With what we've talked about on this Prophecy Today intelligence briefing today, it certainly looks like that alignment of nations is ready to go against the Jewish state of Israel. Again, let me remind you, before that happens, the rapture takes place. Thank you very much for joining us on this edition of Prophecy Today Intelligence Briefing. Be sure to come back again next time when we will continue to look at current events in light of biblical prophecy.